I dare say that if we had no other texts in Scripture, in the New Testament, other than the birth narratives and these early narratives from Matthew and from Luke, we could still get to the heart of the Christmas story. It's all there in the text. If you look at our world, look at our world and see what is happening. It's all in this text, isn't it? I'm always intrigued by the fact that on Christmas Eve, people come to worship who worship at no other time of the year. They might show up at Easter, perhaps, because their mother made them come. But there's something about the Christmas story that causes people to come. Why would people come on Christmas Eve or Easter to be greeted by my former associate and colleague in ministry, Jack, in Cincinnati? Why would they be greeted with the greeting, "It's so good to see all of you here this evening. It's so good to see all of you who have so cleverly disguised yourselves as empty pews since the last Christmas Eve. I want it to sink under the pulpit." It's not a way to greet people. The question is, why do they come? What is it about these stories that will not let us ignore them? Well, first of all, I've just come to the conclusion that we are starved for wonder. What a wonder. We are starved for that which is wonderful, that which is extraordinary in the midst of the ordinary, something that breaks open the patterns and gives us a window into heaven, a window into God. And on Christmas Eve and in these Christmas stories, it's as though the heavens open and the light shines that we cannot ignore in our darkness. And it is into this darkness that the Christmas story comes. It's a dark world. It's the world where Caesar reigns. The time of the Roman Empire, and so Caesar has declared that all of his subjects in all of the parts of where Jesus and where Mary and Joseph and everybody else lives in this out-of-the-way precinct go to their own town to be registered, to be taxed. And you've got Herod, who was the kind of the governor who is supposed to keep peace there. You can have your kingship, Herod, but if there are uprisings and if you don't keep them in hand, then we'll find another king, thank you. So Herod is terrified by the possibility of any uprising or any threat to his position. And so the Magi come, these figures, not three of them, we don't know how many there are, but the Magi come from someplace else, from Iran probably, from Persia back then. And they come in the story and they ask Herod, because Herod is supposed to know, where is the new king? Who's to be born king of the Jews? And Herod gets all uptight. And he says, yeah, that would probably be in Bethlehem. So when you go and find him, then just come back and tell me so I can go worship him too. So Herod tries to make spies out of the Magi. But the appointed spies are too smart for that. They are wisdom figures. They're wise men. And so they do not return to Herod, but they depart from their own for their own country after having presented the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And it all happens in Bethlehem, in a place where there was no room for them in the inn. Outside of the normal lodgings of people, a family that is temporarily homeless or who is maybe given lodging, but in a house where the animals are. And you get Jesus as an infant, as a refugee. Jesus, Joseph is warned, he takes his wife Mary and he takes Jesus and he goes into Egypt and they stay there for a while until everything looks like it's clear according to the dream and he comes back and then there's Herod's son. So all of this, it is full of political intrigue, isn't it? Just like now. Just like today. And so here we are at the end of 2013. How many of you are sorry that this year is coming to an end? Oh, Jesse, what happened? Did you get married or something? Anyway, how many of you are looking forward to 2014? How many of you don't care? Okay, well, okay, that's good. Well, it's a wonderful. I was told when I came here that this was a congregation of great diverse opinion. So now we know. But think about this past year and how wacky it's been. All the issues having to do with government. Good government, bad government, politicians, good politicians, bad politicians, selfish politicians, the internet, Target, your credit cards, more events like Newtown, on safety. Yesterday's Star Tribune, and perhaps you saw it on television on the local news, carried the story of a wonderful man named Mark Andrew. I knew Mark when I was at the Legal Rights Center, and he helped us a couple of times to find money, which nonprofits all need. Well, Mark Andrews, it turns out, in the weighted voting for mayor of Minneapolis, came in second. And Mark Andrew was sitting at a Starbucks at the Mall of America with his iPhone out, and somebody grabbed his iPhone and ran off with it, and Mark Andrew ran after it. And they beat him to a pulp when he finally got there. Well, what's happening at the Mall of America? we can't even shop anymore. Oh my gosh, the world is going to come to an end if we can't shop. And then at the same time yesterday, I get this posting on Facebook. Old college classmate wrote that she had stopped in at a Walmart for some plastic bins that she knew Walmart would carry. These were, I don't know what kind of bins, she didn't say, but plastic containers that she knew Walmart would have, and she's no fan of Walmart. She pretty much detests it. But she needed the containers, so she went into Walmart to buy the containers, and a fight broke out in the Walmart between four people. Two men, two women, in a fisticuffs, pushing and shouting and yelling, going after each other while the Walmart employees tried to break it up, and then finally somebody had the good sense to yell, "Police!" and scattered for the door. And the fight was over. Well, responding to my friend's Walmart shopping experience, came a number of responses, about 20 of them actually, from her good friends scolding her for shopping at Walmart. And they all but mugged her on cyberspace for shopping there and for violating her own principles. And then she responded by saying, I'm sorry, but enough already. Enough already. Well, it's ugly out there. Obviously, it's ugly out there at Walmart. It's ugly in the Mall of America. We want stuff. We want it fast. We want it cheap. We don't care at whoever else's expense we may get it. And as if that weren't enough, sometimes the fights break out on our own computer screens about who's been naughty and who's been nice. Who's going to get presents and who's going to get coal in their stocking. So I've concluded that shopping is bad for our health. And the next time I shop someplace that violates my own conscience or somebody else and a fight breaks out, I'm not going to be posting it on social media on the site that ends with K, not my wife, but the letter K. And besides that, I am a terrible coward. They can have my iPhone, they can have anything I want, anything I might have. I'm leaving the mall and Walmart for the locally owned shops. If only I could find one. Violence. Ignorance. Meanness. Selfishness. And into the midst of all of this in our time, there comes this magnificent Pope who named himself after Francis of Assisi, the guy who went around as a pauper. And he said, the one who was named now as the Time Magazine Man of the Year said, just as the commandment thou shalt not kill sets a clear limit in order to safeguard the value of human life, today we also have to say, thou shalt not, to an economy of exclusion and inequality. Such an economy kills, said Pope Francis. A lot of people don't like what he had to say. The economic disciples of Ayn Rand's virtue of selfishness, many of whom attend Mass or some other Christian worship service on Sunday, only to act on Monday morning as if they had never been to worship, have met their match in the Pope, Time's Man of the Year, a spiritual figure who calls us to look at our patterns of living and shopping and behaving with one another and arranging ourselves in community in a different way. Economics and politics are spiritual matters. And anybody who thinks they are not should go back and read the texts of Matthew and of Luke, right from the very beginning of the story of Jesus. Economics is a spiritual matter. It always has been. It always will be. And so thank you, Pope Francis, for speaking truth with clarity and calling us to a better way. How we get there, none of us knows. How we get from here to there, none of us knows. But what we do know as people of faith is that we will not get there any other way than by paying attention to the Jesus stories. It's all there, brothers and sisters. Every ounce of it is right there in the stories about wonder, about God's glory, about light that shines in the darkness, about the departure of the wise figures by another way than returning to Herod, who conscripted them. Let none of us be conscripted by this upside down system, and let us instead be recruited again today and tomorrow and the day after that as citizens of the kingdom of God. Amen.